Hey guys, this is Caleb from the Command Valley coming at you with another Deck Tech featuring a brand new Jumpstart Commander. Here on the Command Valley, we talk about all things Commander, provide you with weekly Deck Techs to help you brew, gameplay videos, and so much more. Be sure to check out our gameplay series, Duel of the Peaks. Episode 6 is out, which means we are halfway through the season already. Before we get into the video, I'd like to give a huge shout out to our channel sponsor, GameGrid Lehigh. If you are in the Utah County area, definitely check out their store. They've got an amazing card archive, a huge selection of card and deck accessories, and an incredibly helpful and friendly staff. Also, please be sure to like this video, subscribe if you haven't yet, and even hit that bell to be notified about our weekly deck techs and other videos. We truly appreciate all of your support. With that out of the way, let me introduce today's commander, Naoth of the Dire Hunt. Naoth costs 2 generic and 2 green mana to cast. She's a human warrior and says, whenever one or more creatures you control fight or become blocked, draw a card. Card draw on a commander is absolutely fantastic and it's relatively easy to trigger, especially thanks to her second ability. It says, at the beginning of combat on your turn, you may pay 2 and a hybrid red-green. If you do, double target creature's power until end of turn. That creature must be blocked this combat if able. Being able to keep our hand fueled and ready with more cards in an aggressive gruel strategy is super important, and Naoth is going to do a fantastic job at making sure that you never run out of cards to play. It's also important to note that even though she looks like a mono green commander, she is in fact a gruel commander, thanks to her second ability having the hybrid red-green symbol in her text box. As with all of the best commanders, there are plenty of ways that you can build your Naoth deck. To get the most out of Naoth, you're obviously going to be focusing on creatures and fighting, but you can take this in an infect direction, or death touch, or huge creatures, or a combination of any of these strategies. For my deck, I've decided to keep it simple and run tons of big creatures, lots of ramp, and creatures and spells that cause my creatures to fight with a small death touch sub-theme. One of the first types of creatures you should consider running are creatures that have the fight ability stapled right on them. Brash Taunter is a brand new card from M21 that costs 4 and a red to cast. It's a 1/1 goblin with indestructible, and it also says, whenever Brash Taunter is dealt damage, it deals that much damage to target opponent. Then, for 2 and a red and then tap it, Brash Taunter fights another target creature. So we've basically got a color-restricted stuffy doll that fights instead of pinging itself, which is so good in this deck. Not to mention, you get to choose which opponent you want to slap in the face each time instead of just the opponent that you name as you play stuffy doll. I am super excited to play Brash Taunter. Next up is Foe Razor Regent, and he costs 5 and 2 green for a 4/5 with flying. So far, this card is no bueno, but when it enters the battlefield, you may have it fight target creature that you don't control. To make up for those terrible stats, it also says, whenever a creature you control fights, put 2 +1/+1 counters on it at the beginning of the next end step. I really hate that this thing doesn't just immediately put counters on your creatures, especially for the ridiculous CMC, but it's really not bad, especially if we can get it out early with lots of ramp. You're going to be making your creatures huge with this guy. Gargos Vicious Watcher is an 8/7 for 6, which by itself is not bad, and he comes with Vigilance, plus he reduces the cost of your Hydras by 4, and then says, whenever a creature you control becomes the target of a spell, Gargos fights up to one target creature you don't control. This has so much application in this deck. With Gargos on the field, if one of your opponents tries to bounce, steal, copy, kill, or target in any way one of your creatures, Gargos gets to fight. With Gargos out, you can also target one of your small or one of your big death touch creatures that we'll get into later with one of your fight spells, which will cause Gargos's ability to trigger, so he will fight, and then your death touch creature will fight, and if you've got Naoth, that is actually a case where you would get to draw 2 cards for each of those individual fights. Again, Gargos is fantastic. If you don't have one, definitely pick one up. One really easy way to draw a ton of cards in this deck is by playing Growthama. And not just playing it, but playing it at just the right time, because it will easily get you 10 or more cards with Naoth and other creatures out on the field. Growthama gives all other creatures the ability to fight it when they attack, including your opponents, so be careful with this card. Then, when it leaves the battlefield, each player draws cards equal to the amount of damage dealt to Grothama that turn by sources they controlled. So if you've got more than 8 power on the board, you play Grothama, attack with all of your creatures, fight him with all of your creatures, kill Grothama, then draw a card from Naoth for the fights, and then draw cards equal to the amount of damage that you did to him, you're going to have a ton of cards. I've seen players draw more than 40 cards off of killing Grothama at just the right moment. Gruul Rage Beast costs a whopping 7 mana to cast, but it fights a creature an opponent controls when it enters the battlefield, and it makes it so that the rest of your creatures fight your opponent's creatures when they ETB. Kogla the Titan Ape costs 3 and 3 green and fights up to 1 target creature you don't control when it ETBs. It also says, whenever Kogla attacks, destroy target artifact or enchantment defending player controls, which is super nice. Plus, it has an activated ability for 1 and a green, which returns target human you control to its owner's hand. Kogla then gains indestructible until end of turn. This is super nice because you can use it to not only protect Kogla, but also Naoth, who is a human, from board wipes and or other removal. Ravager Worm has Riot, and you get to have it fight a creature you don't control or destroy a land with an activated ability that isn't a mana ability when it ETBs. Territorial Allosaurus can be played as a vanilla 5/5 for 2 and 2 green, or it can be kicked for an additional 2 and a green to fight any target when it ETBs. Thorn Mammoth has Trample, and it fights up to 1 creature you don't control whenever it or another creature you control enters the battlefield. For 1 and a green, you can tap Ulvenwald Tracker to have target creature you control fight another target creature. When Voracious Hydra enters the battlefield, you can either double the number of +1/+1 counters on it, or you can have it fight another target creature you don't control. You could also play Golden Guardian, which flips into Gold Forge Garrison if you use its activated ability to fight something and it dies in the same turn. Lastly, Wicked Wolf fights when he ETBs, but he's really not that impressive in the deck, so you can play him if you've got him. He's not making it into my final cut. Now let's talk about some non-creature cards that cause our creatures to fight. There are a lot of them, so you might be tempted to go kinda crazy at first, but I suggest running 6 to 9 depending on what your strategy is. Remember to put in a lot of creatures that have fight stapled on them already, so that you can run fewer non-creature fight cards, which will then open up your deck for more ramp, card draw, and other interaction. The nice thing about most of these cards is that they're cheap, both to buy and to cast, and will draw you a card when you use them with Naoth out. Arena is a land that was originally printed in the early 90s as a promo and then reprinted in Time Spiral in 2006. I bring this up because we are going to read the Oracle text instead of what is actually on the card. Arena doesn't tap for any mana, but you can pay 3 and tap it to tap target creature you control and target creature of an opponent's choice that they control. Those creatures fight each other. So even though there isn't a printed version of the card that specifically says those creatures fight, this does work with Naoth thanks to that Oracle text. This is a great way to get multiple fights out of one card. The only downsides to this card are that it does count as a land drop when you play it, and the fact that your opponent gets to choose which creature to send in to fight in the arena. One quick warning, do not count this land as a land that taps for mana when building your deck. Pretend that this land just doesn't even exist when building your mana base. As for actual spells, I would encourage you to run mostly instants like Ancient Animus, Pit Fight, Setessan Tactics, and Titanic Brawl over the many sorceries that allow one of your creatures to fight. Prey Upon might be an exception only because it costs just 1 mana, but if you're going to run sorceries that allow you to fight, then make sure that they're worth it. Primal Might, the brand new sorcery from M21, is a great example. With Primal Might, you can beef up one of your tramplers, have it fight, draw a card from Naoth, then at the beginning of combat, use your last bit of mana to double that creature's power using Naoth's other ability, and make it have to be blocked, swing, most certainly kill your opponent's creature, draw another card from Naoth, and probably get in some trample damage while you're at it. So for me, Primal Might was definitely worth running. Some other options for instant fight spells that you could run are Pounce and Unnatural Aggression, which actually exiles your opponent's creature that fights if it dies the same turn that you play it. If you have to, or you just want to, here are some sorceries that you could also consider running. Epic Confrontation, Go for Blood, Joust, Outmuscle, Savage Punch, Savage Smash, and Savage Swipe. Again, I would only play these if I did not have some of the better, faster, and more efficient cards that we've already talked about. You've also got two Planeswalkers that you can play with loyalty abilities that cause your creatures to fight. They are Domri Raid and Domri Anarch of Bolas. They are both super cool. Neither of them is bad. I would not fault anyone for playing them in this deck. Unfortunately, they did not make it into my first final cut, but they are in my pool of cards that I will be testing in and out of this deck at the moment. So who knows, they might actually eventually make it. If you want to play them, go for it. Last but definitely not least is Azuri's Predation. This card is awesome, but it is expensive to cast and also to buy, unfortunately. For 5 generic and 3 green mana, you've got a sorcery that says, for each creature your opponents control, put a 4/4 green beast creature token onto the battlefield. Each of those beasts fights a different one of those creatures. Man, this card makes me so sad and so happy at the same time. Sadly, its ability only draws you one card with Naoth out, no matter how many creatures fight. But this has the potential to be a very one-sided board wipe and can save you in a pinch in the late game. Next, let's talk about some other cards that will benefit from or give us value for fighting and using Naoth's last ability. Hungering Hydra costs X and a green and enters the battlefield with a number of +1/+1 counters equal to X. It can't be blocked by more than one creature, and it says whenever Hungering Hydra is dealt damage, put that many +1/+1 counters on it. It must survive the damage to get the counters. So basically, every time this thing fights or gets blocked, which you can force with Naoth, it gets bigger. If only this thing had trample. Ilharg the Razebor can cheat a creature into play each turn when it attacks, and that creature gets sent back to our hand at the end of the turn. I didn't include him in my final cut, but I was thinking that it would be fun to cheat cards like Ravager Worm into play so that it could fight and draw me cards each turn. Creatures like Ripjaw Raptor and Polyraptor are perfect for our aggressive strategy. Enrage triggers whenever they are dealt damage. Ripjaw Raptor will draw us a card each time, and Polyraptor makes copies of itself. Vigor is probably one of my favorite cards in the whole deck. For 3 generic and 3 green mana, he's a 6/6 with trample and says, if damage would be dealt to another creature you control, prevent that damage. Put a +1/+1 counter on that creature for each 1 damage prevented this way. Also, when he dies, he gets shuffled into its owner's library. Vigor is absolutely nuts, and he also slots into our protection category, which we will talk about in a bit. With Vigor out, whenever any of your creatures are dealt damage, be it through combat or fighting or any other means, they get bigger instead. Vigor is fantastic. The last card I want to talk about in this category ties perfectly into the next section of the deck, and that card is Hornet Nest. Hornet Nest costs 2 generic and 1 green for a 0/2 with Defender. It also says, whenever Hornet Nest is dealt damage, put that many 1/1 green insect creature tokens with flying and death touch onto the battlefield. This card has multiple functions. The first is that it can prevent your opponents from attacking you with anything too big that doesn't have trample or flying, of course. Your opponents aren't going to want to deal your Hornet Nest a bunch of damage because that will create you an army of flying death touchers, which is absolutely terrifying. You can, however, use one of your instant speed fight spells to get their, say, 6/6 to fight with it, and you'll be trading in your Hornet Nest for an army of Hornets. Speaking of death touch, it's really good in this deck. Hornet Queen gives us 5 flying death touching insects, including itself, to be used as either deterrents or as attackers that Naoth can force your opponents to block, then trade with, and you get to draw a card. Wyrmcoil Engine is an absolute monster in this deck. It costs 6 generic. It is a 6/6 with death touch and lifelink. If your opponents don't block and or kill this thing, it's going to keep swinging in for a ton of damage and gain you a ton of life, and it gets absolutely crazy when Naoth doubles its power. If it does eventually die, it splits into 2 3/3s, one with lifelink and the other with death touch. If you can get Wyrmcoil Engine out, you're most likely going to get at least 2 of your opponent's creatures with this thing, and you're going to draw some cards thanks to it, and you're definitely going to gain some life from it, so have fun playing it. Another big death touch creature that we can play is Ronus the Indomitable. For 3, it's a 5/5 with death touch and indestructible. However, it can't attack or block unless you control another creature with power 4 or greater, which is no problem in this deck. He has the ability to pay 3, and then another target creature gets +2/+0 and gains trample until end of turn. So again, it's super simple to get this guy online in this deck. The nice thing about these big Death Touch creatures is if your opponents don't block them, they take tons of damage, and if they do block them, they're definitely going to lose a creature and you're going to draw a card from Naoth. Other big Death Touch creatures include God Eternal Ronus, Orin Frostfang, and Questing Beast. I especially like Orin Frostfang, even though it doesn't have the most power ever. It doesn't really matter because it gives all attacking creatures you control Death Touch and says, whenever a creature you control deals combat damage to a player, draw a card. Now all of your creatures have Death Touch when they swing, forcing your opponents to really think about how they're going to block or not block, but it doesn't matter much to you because you're going to be drawing a ton of cards and dealing damage or killing their stuff. Either way, Orin Frostfang makes almost all swings a win-win for you. I've included a lot of big fatties in my deck, and I don't normally do this without a way to cheat them in. Two of my favorite commanders are Mael and Jota, and my decks work really well when it comes to cheating out big creatures and spells. I was feeling a lot less comfortable with my high CMC creatures while building this deck, so I have included 13 and a half ramp spells. I even tested it at 15. That seemed like just a little too much, but I would definitely recommend having a ton in your Naoth deck if your curve looks anything like mine. I would include 10 ramp cards minimum, 13 to 14 maximum. The tricky thing I found with this deck is that a lot of your 3 drops and less are fight cards, and they're almost always useless early on, so be sure to keep that in mind as you examine your curve. Also, use that space to fill your deck with a lot of low-costing ramp. In my deck, I've included Sol Ring, Arcane Signet, Gruul Signet, Star Compass, Cultivate, Farseek, Fertile Ground, Kodama's Reach, Nature's Lore, Rampant Growth, Skyshroud Claim, Wild Growth, and Selvala as my 13, then Goreclaw, Terror of Chalcisma as my last half of a ramp slot. Goreclaw reduces our creature spells with power 4 or greater by 2 generic mana, and it says, whenever Goreclaw attacks, each creature you control with power 4 or greater gets +1/+1 and gains trample until end of turn. This is an absolutely fantastic card to get out early game. I do not recommend running high CMC ramp like Gilded Lotus or Chromatic Orrery. Skyshroud Claim barely made it into the deck and may eventually get cut because of its awkward timing for something cheaper like Talisman of Impulse or Steve. It's best to get as much ramp as early as possible with this deck to be able to get out Naoth and then start getting value from her. This is a deck that can work without the commander, but you should always try to have her on the field. Speaking of getting value, let's talk about some other ways that we can draw cards in this deck. Definitely don't fall into the trap of thinking that you shouldn't run any draw spells just because Naoth has draw stapled onto her. We've already talked about Ripjaw Raptor and Orin Frostfang, but another creature that will help us draw cards is Beast Whisperer. Each time we cast a creature, we draw a card, simple and useful. We've got a couple of enchantments that we can run, and I've gone with the brand new Garrick's Uprising and, of course, Guardian Project. I don't think that I've done a single deck tech for a green commander without mentioning Guardian Project. It draws you a card each time a non-token creature ETBs under your control. It's great, it's awesome, run it, it's great. Garrick's Uprising draws you a card when it ETBs if you control a creature with power 4 or greater, and it gives all of your creatures trample, already loving it. And it also says, whenever a creature with power 4 or greater enters the battlefield under your control, draw a card. This is awesome, and I can't wait to play it for the first time since it just came out, and I hope it turns out great. Momentous Fall is an instant that costs 4, and you have to sacrifice a creature as an additional cost to cast it. You then draw cards equal to the sacrificed creature's power and gain life equal to its toughness. I honestly haven't played a lot with this card, but the fact that it is an instant seems really good to me. You can cast it in response to your Wyrmcoil Engine getting targeted by a Path to Exile. You can use it right after or even during combat on a creature that's been buffed by Naoth for even more card draw. It's got a lot of potential with a bit of a downside, but just remember to play stuff on your second main phase if you can, especially while this is in your hand and you plan on attacking, just in case one of your creatures gets targeted by instant speed removal during combat or some other shenanigans. Return of the Wild Speaker is a super versatile instant that lets you choose to either draw cards equal to the greatest power among non-human creatures you control, or non-human creatures you control get +3/+3 until end of turn. As long as you've got non-creature cards on the board, this card is good in many circumstances, but especially late game as either a finisher or fishing for a win con. Rishkar's expertise draws you cards equal to the greatest power among creatures you control. So if you target your Wyrmcoil Engine, you'll draw 6 cards. Then it lets you cast a card with CMC 5 or less from your hand for free. Some other noteworthy cards that made it into my deck are Fierce Empath, which tutors for a creature with CMC 6 or greater when it ETBs, Eternal Witness, and Skullwinder. Both Eternal Witness and Skullwinder return a card from your graveyard to your hand when they ETB. However, Skullwinder also makes you choose an opponent and they get to return a card as well, so choose wisely. Skullwinder also fits into our Death Touch section. Other cards that you can consider playing in this section include Hunter's Insight, Lifecrafter's Bestiary, Infiltration Lens, Shamanic Revelation, Harmonize, and Elemental Bond. With all the fighting going on in this deck, the little bit of extra removal was easy to choose because I felt like I already had creature removal covered. Acidic Slime adds more to our Death Touch package, and it also destroys an artifact, enchantment, or land when it ETBs. Reclamation Sage has become a staple in green and allows you to destroy an artifact or enchantment when it enters the battlefield. Beast Within and Crossing Grip are pretty much the best green removal at instant speed. So how do we protect our stuff from getting blown up, countered, killed in combat, etc.? We already talked about Vigor, he is definitely in this category. Heroic Intervention has received a much needed reprint in the latest core set, so definitely pick that one up while they're hot off the press and under $10. It will give all of your permanents hexproof and indestructible until end of turn for just 2 mana at instant speed. Lightning Greaves and Swiftfoot Boots are great for protecting our commander and giving our creatures haste. Vexing Shusher is around 15 to 20 bucks at the moment, but if you've got a playgroup that likes to play blue and is constantly countering your win cons, then he just might be worth the investment. For 2 hybrid red-green, he's a 2/2 goblin shaman that can't be countered. He has an ability that costs 1 hybrid red-green that says, target spell can't be countered by spells or abilities. If you're tired of having your Xanagos God of Revels, your Wyrmcoil Engine, or your Triumph of the Hordes countered, then definitely grab yourself one of these cool little dudes and say no more to blue. A good budget option that also made it into my first final cut is Rhythm of the Wild. It's an enchantment that costs 1 generic, 1 red, and 1 green to cast, and it makes it so that your creature spells can't be countered, and your non-token creatures have Riot. It's a little bit of a do-nothing enchantment the first turn that you play it, but it's well worth it the next turn when you cast your commander worry-free while also giving it either haste or a +1/+1 counter depending on what the board state looks like. We've had quite a few requests to talk about our land bases recently, so I'll go over this one fairly quick. Command Tower and Fabled Passage are the only rainbow lands that I'm running. Fabled Passage might seem a little strange in this deck, but it's really heavy on green, so I like having the extra bit of flexibility that will let me go search up a mountain if I really need one. Stomping Ground, Sheltered Thicket, and Cinderglade are dual lands that can be searched for with cards like Farseek, Nature's Lore, and Skyshot Claim thanks to their Mountain Forest subtype. Other duels in my deck include Game Trail, Rootbound Crag, and Temple of Abandon. Homeward Path has absolutely nothing to do with a future gameplay video that we may or may not be filming soon, and entirely to do with the fact that getting your stuff stolen is the absolute worst. You don't have to play this card, especially if you don't own one because it's super expensive, but if you do have one, this is a worthy deck to include it in because nothing is worse than getting your huge creatures that you worked so hard for stolen by someone who definitely does not deserve them. Other utility lands that I would encourage you to run are Kesig Wolfrun, Mosswarp Bridge, Skarg the Rage Pits, and of course Arena. The deck is currently running 17 forests and 7 mountains. If you add it all up, I am playing 37 lands, including Arena. Lastly, let's talk about some ways to close out the game. Chandra's Ignition is great in many circumstances. If you need a board wipe and you've got a creature with Death Touch, then target it with Chandra's Ignition and it will deal damage equal to its power to each other creature and each opponent, and Death Touch does apply in this case. Note that it will also deal damage to all of your opponents, not just creatures. So you can use Naoth to double one of your creature's power during combat, then target it with Chandra's Ignition during the second main phase to deal some massive damage. Disrupt Decorum is another versatile card that goads all creatures that you don't control. The reminder text for goad says, until your next turn, those creatures attack each combat if able, and attack a player other than you if able. This card is super great during the late game when we've already got a big board full of fatties, but our opponents do as well. Your opponents will be forced to start killing each other, and by the time it's your turn again, they should be mostly wide open. Overwhelming Stampede, Endraiser Forerunners, Triumph of the Hordes, and Craterhoof Behemoth all win by buffing your creatures in one way or another and by giving them trample. These are classic overrun style cards that will win you the game out of nowhere. Alright, here are some quick extras before we end the video. Bonds of Mortality and Shadow Spear are great against playgroups and or decks that run a lot of hexproof and indestructible commanders or creatures in general because they open the path to fight and kill them. Quicksilver Amulet, Elvish Piper, and Champion of Ronus are good cards you can include that will help you cheat creatures in. Consider removing some of your higher CMC cards for these in order to make playing your huge creatures easier, especially if you're having a hard time getting your deck going. And last but not least, Berserker's Onslaught gives all of your creatures double strike, which is absolutely insane if you are leaning more heavily into the Death Touch and or Infect strategies. Alright, you've made it to the end of this video. Thank you so much for watching. I have left a lot of the deck building decisions up to you, so have fun brewing Naoth. If you're watching this on YouTube, please feel free to comment below and tell us what you'll be playing in your Naoth deck. Also, let us know if you have any questions, if you noticed something that we missed, and what other commanders you'd be interested in seeing us do videos for. Please like this video, subscribe to our channel, and hit that bell to be notified about our weekly deck techs, set reviews, and gameplay videos. Subscribing to our channel is the easiest way to help support us, and it's completely free. We really appreciate all of you and your support. Thanks, everybody. Stay safe out there.